Grace and mercy and peace to you. In the name of God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus. Amen. If you join me in a word of prayer. Lord, in the beginning you were the Word, and you were there at the beginning of all things, and you are here, Lord, today in our midst. And Lord, as the Word of God made flesh, you came here for us, your people, and we thank you. We thank you. Lord, be with us today as we listen to the Word, as we reflect on why we have a Scripture, as we think on how the Word lives and dwells among us. Lord, be with us in your name. Amen. You may be seated. I would argue that Thy Strong Word is the best hymn that was written in the last 100 years. It's probably one of the best ones in the last 1,000. So I love that. Such a good hymn. Today we are talking about sola scriptura. We've been talking about these principles of the Reformation, these things that the Reformers 500 years ago, that they said, yes, that's important, and we should really focus our church, our life, our stuff on that. So we've been Jesus Christ alone, that was number one, grace alone, that it is not by anything that you have done, not any work of your own, but by the grace of Jesus Christ that you are brought into Him. And then in faith alone, you receive this. You get to say, yes, I was guilty, I'm now free because of the work of Jesus. Today we're going to look at kind of what started for Luther a lot of this stuff, and that was the principle of sola scriptura. If you haven't been joining us in Bible study, and you're not really familiar with what happened in the Reformation time, at the time of Luther, there were not a lot of Bibles, right? So you can look out in front of you, look in the pew in front of you, and you'll see there'll probably be a blue book in the pew in front of you. It's a Holy Bible, so it'll probably say Holy Bible in front, or the Bible, or something. And we have this kind of tremendous access to this scripture. We have this whole, like, here's, how many of you have a Bible at home? How many of you have a dusty Bible at home, right? Some of you do, right? We have this tremendous access to scripture. Luther didn't have that. Like, this was not his world. The scriptures that existed were rare. They were people. The regular people had no access to them, and it's not until within his life that this changes as he translates the scripture into the German language. Printing presses start picking it up, start printing it, and start making money off of it. It's a whole other thing. But scripture is rare. But for Luther, as he encountered like what was happening within the church, and as he looked at how the church was working or really not working, the thing for him was that scripture is the vehicle in which God has chosen to reveal himself, right? God has chosen to say, this is, here I am, this is what you should know about me, and that's that, right? And the world that he lived in really emphasized a whole bunch of other things. Like, scripture was very important. You know, the church has always said, yes, of course, scripture is very important. But for Luther in particular, the role of tradition was much higher, right? The church had traditions. Churches still have traditions. Occasionally it's good to think that Luther really fought against the traditions of the church, because he said those traditions go against scripture. And so for Luther, as he's dealing with how the church worked and how the church really wasn't working, he said, we have to go and we have to kind of have ourselves a source. And this source will be this scripture that God has inspired people to write, has been passed down, has been copied and copied, and now we're going to make sure that it gets out into the hands of people. Okay, so that's all the scriptura in a nutshell. What are we doing today? We are looking at 1 Corinthians, because the church has always had problems. This is one of the things that's always helpful to read in the early church writings, to read the Old Testament writings. The people of God have always had problems. Like, there's nothing new It's really great to go back and read it and be like, oh yeah, okay, that's good. There's this problem that's existing within the people of God. They're hearing from these different preachers, and they're hearing from these different teachers about Jesus, and that these people, some of them are being elevated over here, and some of them are being denigrated, because rarely do we elevate without putting down, right? And so Paul is writing to a bunch of people who, some of whom follow Apollos, some of whom follow him, and he's like, wait, we're really getting this out of whack. And as we look at 1 Corinthians, you have this kind of word from Paul, word from God, that says the proclaimers of the word, like, it's not about them. Right? This proclamation of the word is not about the proclaimers of the word. The proclaimers of the word, the people who get out there and are saying something about this word, the real point about them is that they are faithful to God. That's their mark. Are they going to be faithful to the word that they are proclaiming? And if so, then great, listen to Apollos, listen to Paul, listen to Peter, listen to whomever. But these people, Apollos, Paul, Peter, whoever gets out and does this proclamation, has to be faithful to God. It has to be faithful to his word. And so Paul says in verse 6, don't go beyond what is written. How many of you like limits? You love having limits. There's actually, I think that there's a lot of us who do like having limits, because it tells us, you know, what are the boundaries of the things that we can do and have, and there's, limits are great. How many of you like to push against your limits? Whatever the limits may be, right? Yeah. There's limits, I'm going to push up against them, I got that. And so Paul, as he gives this warning, don't go beyond the word, and as he has people who are struggling with, you know, the personalities, right? This is something we in the 21st century, we can identify with. Here's the personality of this proclaimer of the word, and I'm going to go after that personality and that person, and, you know, their message may not be accurate to what the word of God is, but I'm going to still follow after them because they're flashy, and they're shiny, or they're whatever. Or, you know, they're highly intellectual, or I'm going to go after the personality of the proclaimer. And Paul is giving this warning to don't go past the word. Don't go past the word. We want to push up against this kind of limitation that exists there with the word. But the word, it's one of the things I think is most interesting about this as a Reformation principle. It is purposefully limiting, right? You have in your, you pick up your Bible, go ahead and pick up a Bible in front of you. You have them in your case, go ahead and pick it up. You have in your hands it, right? That's it. And anytime that the church argued for, well, but we've done it this way, or we've always chosen to do it this way, or we've had this, the reformer said, but is it in Scripture? Does it exist there? If it doesn't exist there, then you're making it up, and we don't have to either follow it or not follow it. We're free to try out something new and work on whatever if we're not forbidden from doing it over here. We're free to listen and to apply this Scripture into this day, whatever day this is. But we're not going to go beyond the word, because if we see that this is contrary to the word, we're not going to do it. It's not going to happen. We're not simply going to follow the traditions of human beings and say, here's this. You know, the most obvious example for the Reformation is the papacy. Okay? There's a pope. He's the head of the church by human right, Luther would say. Pope can be the head of the church by human right, but he is not the head of the church by divine right. There's only one head of the church, that is Jesus Christ. Scripture is clear on this. Pope said, no, I am the head of the church by divine right. It's mine. Right? And he looked and said, no, that's not scripture. There's no scripture that says that's true. Right? We're willing to live in an organization where the Pope could be the head of the church by human authority. But the Pope said, if you don't acknowledge it's by divine authority, then you're not getting it. Right? You're out. Scripture is purposefully limited. And it does so in a lot of ways, but in particular, I think it's around the first commandment to not make this God in our own image. That Scripture is here for us, and it's here for us to read, because there's a tendency in the heart of every human to make God, to fashion God in our own image. We, as God's people, Anne Lamott has this wonderful quote, you can safely assume you've created God in your own image when it turns out that God hates all the same people you do, right? We are really incredibly capable of creating God in our own image. God likes the things we like. He dislikes the things we dislike. And we think we're right with this God. But God intentionally, through his word, challenges who we think he is. When we are people who are after whatever it is that we're after, whether it's prosperity or it's power or whatever, this scripture challenges us to say that that's not what our God is about. It really will challenge cultures. It will confront the cultures. The Roman culture where people were worthless, essentially. Right? There's a lot of slavery. Rome was a very active empire. Very, very, very active. Active armies. They go and they conquer people and they enslave them. Right? And to that, scripture talks a lot about human dignity and about people being made in his image and about people having all of this worth and this worth for Jesus to come for them. So to the Roman Empire, where people are worthless, the scripture confronts their culture. They didn't necessarily like it, right? This is most of the time we don't like we're confronted, but it doesn't. It confronts a meritorious culture. It says that you are saved by grace, not by anything that you have done. I love that about this Lutheran church, that you are saved by grace. There's so much where we will more than likely keep trying to figure out how we merit the worth of God, and every time that we keep running and running and running on that hamster wheel, we will come back to, yes, but it's the only thing that merits God in me is Jesus has chosen to give himself to me. It challenges our meritorious culture. Right, ours here in the 21st century. And it challenges the hedonistic culture. It says, you know what, there are ways in which you should live. There are ways in which you are not contributing to things when you simply are seeking for yourself. Right, and hedonism as a culture was prevalent in the day of Paul, it's prevalent now, and this still challenges and confronts the cultures that exist. This book, right? The one that you all have in front of you, that you are able to pick up, read, and speak. Right? And not to simply speak your own message, but to speak the message that comes from this God. That he will challenge this world as it is. And he will challenge you. He will confront you. So the scripture, this book, offends us. Or at least it should. If it doesn't, you're not reading it right. Right? This scripture should offend you. It should, as you read things within it, you should say, no, but I want my world to be like this. I want it to be ordered this way. I want these people to be punished for what they do, and I want these people to not be punished. And it doesn't matter what crowd you're in, who you want punished, whether you're on one side or the other, because this is how the human body, human brain, human spirit work. Scripture confronts our idolatry. And it confronts the idolatry that is rooted deep within all of us. And so as it confronts the culture, is this gathering of all these beliefs that are out there that we all share. It's there to offend us. And as it offends us, we get to say, you know what? This isn't a human book. Right? It's there, it's written by humans, it has this, but it's not a human book. It's not a book that we say, oh, that's, you know, it's just a random group of people over 1,000+ years writing this. As the Reformers look at the scripture, they say this is something that goes so far beyond us. And so what scripture does, what scripture has, the primary point of this scripture is that it is enough. It's enough for your salvation. Scripture is enough for you to read, to hear, to have. It's enough for your salvation. It's enough. To everything that we would want to add to it, most of the time that comes with us making sure that we're doing something, that we have something, that we're whatever we feel might be lacking on scripture that we would want to add. Scripture says it's enough. And not just the scripture is enough, but what the scripture points to. The scripture points to Jesus Christ as Lord of this world. The scripture points to Jesus Christ as God who takes on human flesh, enters into the world, dies for the sins of the people, according to the system of sacrifice that God had established in the Old Testament. He says, this is it. But he does not simply stay dead, right? The very perfect God himself rises from the dead so that you who face death may rise again as well. That is enough. That message within the scripture is enough for our salvation. It is the work of God in Jesus Christ. That's great. Scripture is enough. It doesn't tell you what to have for dinner, right? You can look in scripture and there will be people who eat at various points and very occasionally, will mention what they ate for dinner. But scripture does not give you that answer. It will not tell you what you should have for dinner today. It won't tell you who you're marrying. It might give you some guidance on what things would be valuable and helpful and useful in a mate. But it will not name names. Right? Scripture is limiting in and of itself in that it does not give you the answer to everything, but it gives you specifically the answer to the thing that is most important. How do I live? How do I live here in time? But more importantly, how do I live into eternity? How do I do this? Where do I look? Where do I trust? How may I be offended and confronted by the fact that I have spent my life and my time living and trusting in myself? And the scripture that is enough, you see this, it is not the vanity of the writers that moves them. Right? In the Old Testament, Moses does not come off well in the books that are ascribed to him. He disobeys God and he dies before getting to the promised land. Into the New Testament, you have Peter who denies Jesus, Paul who calls himself the chief of sinners, Solomon back in the Old Testament again, he chases after women and dies bitter, right? I mean, there's just a lot of stuff in these people, in these books, where absolutely it's not about their vanity. But even the writers of this book, they say, we want you to do one fundamental thing. We want you to read it. We want you to hear it. We want you to have this. We want you to to take up this scripture, scripture alone. Not what I happen to think about God today. Not whatever the church told me that I should think about God today. But to take up the scripture and say, yes, absolutely, in here, I want to hear Jesus. And he speaks. And he will speak to you. He will communicate again and again, and as much as he may confront you and as much as he may offend you, he will also give you his comfort. He will also grant you his peace. He will tell you again and again and again what he does for the sake of his people, of which you are one. Scripture does not tell you everything. This is one of the things in teaching Bible studies that frustrates people, because even in stories that Scripture kind of brings along, it doesn't tell you everything that you want to know that's happening in the story. Well, why was that person mad? Why doesn't do that? What it wants to do is it wants you and me and this world to hear, this is God. This is God. Hear it. And in this Reformation, embrace that sola scriptura, scripture alone, is the vehicle that God has chosen to use, it purposefully limiting, but the vehicle he has chosen to use to communicate himself to you. He desires for you to hear. He wants this more than anything. And he gives this into your hands to listen. In his name, amen. Lord Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for the scripture, that the scripture alone is the way in which you've chosen to communicate yourself into us. Lord, we ask that we pick it up and read it, that the Spirit move in us by the reading of this word, and that it, as we hear it, as we receive it, we do not go beyond it, but Lord, we take what is given, and as we proclaim this word, we rejoice that this word has come to us, and comes to us, and goes out from us. Lord, your word is living and active. Lord, be with us. Keep us steadfast in your word. Make your strong word rule our lives. We ask this, Jesus, in your precious name. Amen.